Who wants to play a game? Great. Yeah, we won't be having any insults, so yeah, I need a volunteer. Okay, come on. So, yeah. We won't be playing with swords, but we'll be playing with tic-tac-toe. So, what's your name?
Bert.
Bert, great. You'll be Alice from now on.
Okay. Can do that.
Yeah, so here you can start the game, you can join the game that I start, and yeah, that's basically it. So you can start a game, maybe. So here we can see that Alice started the game, and there is a Bob in the other browser. Oh, let me find the cursor. So I can join the game now. Okay, let's see what Bob is doing, or what Alice is doing. Okay, so it's your turn, so you can play it. Great. So me. Okay. Yeah, we can start another one. Maybe somebody wins.
Should somebody win or lose?
Okay, I started one for you, so I think you need to go back to games and go to this game, okay? Yeah. No, do your best.
Really?
Yeah. I'm the rubber, you're the glue. Go on, go on. Nice. Okay, great job. Okay, so let me set up the Wi-Fi and continue with the presentation. Create network. Just a second. Okay, it should work. Come on. Nice. Okay. So there are two facts about multiplayer games. Players expect a snappy interface, and the other one is that players usually cheat. And what does it mean is that the game logic, in this example, a tic-tac-toe, so there are a couple of rules to win a game, to make a next move. So the game logic needs to be implemented on each client in a multiplayer game. And also, because players cheat, the game logic needs to be implemented on the server. So it used to mean a lot of redundancy. Because then we have a Rails server, then we have a JavaScript application, and then we have an iOS application, and so on, so on. But now, we have the technology With Opal.rb, we can create Ruby applications in a browser. So has anyone here used Opal before? Great, three people, maybe? OK. So Opal.rb is a Ruby to JavaScript compiler. It's quite fast. It's actively developed. It's not that stable yet, but it works. And it has some drawbacks, but it allows us to create actual Ruby applications in JavaScript, which is quite a good thing. Then there is RubyMotion. How many of you use RubyMotion? Nice, half of you. So RubyMotion is a Ruby to Objective-C compiler. And from like 2 weeks ago, there is also an Android toolkit for RubyMotion. It doesn't work that great yet, but let's say in a year it will work as good as Objective-C one. It has close to the native performance because it's compiled to Objective-C runtime and to Java compiled classes for Android. It's actively developed and it's quite widely used in production. So there are also there are already working applications made in RubyMotion, like 37 Signals Basecamp, for example. There is also mruby. And how many of you use mruby or used it? None. OK. So this one is pretty interesting. It basically supports ISO Ruby standard. And it can be embedded into any C application or any C library. So it means you can put it into any kind of application that can be linked with C. So with mruby, you can potentially create applications that run on any platform, on Windows, on Android, on iOS, Linux, whatever works. So it works even on Arduino Due, because it requires quite a lot of RAM, like 96 kilobytes. So it won't run on the plain old Arduino. But it works on Raspberry Pi, Arduino Due, and a couple of other embedded devices. And yeah, so it's basically promising for Windows desktop applications. But are any of those Ruby-like things really a Ruby? Well, kind of. There are some differences. For example, in RubyMotion, we don't have required runtime. So everything is statically compiled. And Apple doesn't allow us to generate code at runtime. So basically, we get a warning when we require something. There is no eval at runtime. We can still use metaprogramming, but not the one that involves parsing Ruby at runtime. But we can still use define method using block and things like that. So there is this difference with Ruby MRI that threads are actually working. So if you port things from MRI to RubyMotion and you use threads before, then you might find some bugs that you haven't found before. And it doesn't have garbage collection. So it uses automatic reference counting in Objective-C. So memory leaks are actually possible. They're not that common right now. But if you use blocks and events, then it's possible to have one. Then there is Opal.rb. And this basically works in a browser. And it compiles to JavaScript. So requiring files also don't make any sense. Every require statement is translated into Sprockets directive if you use it in Rails. Strings are like in JavaScript, are immutable. Symbols are strings, unfortunately. because the focus was on the performance of the language, and there was no better way to implement symbols in JavaScript. There are differences in a couple of things, like regular expressions are implemented as JavaScript regular expressions, which are different from Ruby, obviously. And all numbers are floats, JavaScript. Yeah, but there is for loop already. So when I gave the talk half a year ago, for loop wasn't implemented, but it's they work on the language, like they work on the compiler all the time, so for loop is already there. So that's a good thing. With mruby, still, no required runtime. If you want to include gems, they work in a different way. So you need to actually compile them into mruby library upfront. So the focus of mruby is on the size of the program. The mats want it to be small as possible. So there are a lot of things in Ruby that are not in in mruby. For example, regular expressions are not there by default. You can include a MR gem, it's the version of gem for mruby, to include the missing functionality. But you cannot do it on during runtime. You could probably implement some system on top of that, but that's up to you. And it's optimized for size, and this is interesting because of that, it's often faster than MRI. But that's a side effect. So the main question is that, are all of those really a Ruby? They're Ruby enough. So if we don't think about the differences and get rid of them and see what is the common subset of those languages, we'll have cross-platform Ruby. And the idea of making the applications in cross-platform Ruby is to have some core logic into in this subset of common code written in the cross-platform Ruby, and have different platforms use that. So do any one of you recognize the shapes here or something like that? Does it ring a bell? Like the hexagon in the middle? Okay, so it's basically similar concept to hexagonal architecture that Uncle Bob is talking about. He's basically talking about extracting the core logic of the application and have adapters for example, database, so we can switch databases easily. You can have adapters for GUI if you need to present everything in a different way. So the idea is to have the application work in a command line, the application work in Rails, and just switch adapters if you want to use different ones. But when it comes to whole platforms, it's actually not feasible to abstract all of that. So how would you imagine to abstract the whole iOS? That's just silly. So it actually looks like that. The idea is to have like the small subset of functionalities. For example, let's say we want to save something, and we need to save it in iOS. We need to save our models in Android or in the browser. Then we can extract the saving functionality to some pattern like repository or something like that, implement it in plain Ruby, add interfaces to that on different platforms, and use it. So the most interesting thing about that are the interactions between all of those systems. The first and easiest one are the internal interactions. So how do we implement communication between the cross-platform Ruby components? So there are different ideas. clean architecture, hexagonal, DCI, DDD, cowboy coding. Why not? This is your dreamland. You can do whatever you want. This is plain Ruby, no database, no GUI, no apps, no different, well, no internet connection, just plain Ruby classes. You can do whatever you want there. It's a great place to be. Tests are fast in this domain, and yeah, it works great. Then we have different kind of interactions. So when we want to access the cross-platform Ruby components from the outside, so we have the iOS application, we have the Rails application, and we have some small component that does something for us. So, sorry. For example, let's say we have translator module that will provide translations for labels or something like that. So we basically create the interface on the cross-platform side and then access it from iOS, we access it from Rails, and we do it in the same way. So basically here, yeah, it's the really simple simple idea. So we just want to get a text for the label that is the same on iOS and in the Rails application. The other thing we could do, for example, in this way, let's say we want to know what users do with our application, so we implement something like Kiss Metrics or something like that, and we want to encapsulate that into some kind of interface and use it on iOS and use it on Rails. So we have different events, we have different user behavior, but the core interface for saving the events is the same. So we can actually encapsulate that and use the same thing on both platforms. The next thing is when we drive our application from inside. So the code that matters is in the cross-platform Ruby side, and we want to access the code on the outside. For example, let's say we have iOS, we have the browser, and we have some kind of wizard that have some panels, and we want to animate them. And if we encapsulate the different ways of implementing that on a specific platform in a common interface, we can actually encapsulate the logic of, let's say, this wizard into cross-platform Ruby, and then drive it in the same way from one place. And the last type of interactions are asynchronous ones. So let's say we have a to-do item, and we have the method mark it as done. And we want to save it afterwards on each platform. So the saving on the different platforms might mean the different thing. For example, saving in Ruby, in Rails, it might be just saving it using Active Record to the database. But saving it in the web browser might be actually creating a post request to the Rails application. And let's say we want to have the same interface for that. So if we want a common interface with interactive applications, let's say we have a mobile application, we press to do, and we wanted to have it in the background and be have the user interface updated automatically. So we need to have some kind of mechanism to have a synchronous interface. So we can implement that in three different ways. So we can use the abstract interface, so the same thing as in the previous previous slide when we drive the applications from inside, we can use some kind of notifications like events or key value observers, or we can use abstract aspect-oriented programming. So with abstract interface, we need to modify our class that is in the cross-platform component. So let's say we inject some kind of saver object that will do the right thing on each platform. And then after market has done, we just do saver save method. And on different platforms, we could, for example, save it to database. We could save it via post request or something like that. And this has a pretty this is a pretty good idea because like it has well-defined interactions, and it's useful when use cases on each platform are similar. So if we want to save the to-do item on different platforms, then creating the same interface for saving them is a good idea. But then the core, our cross-platform Ruby component, needs to know about saving. And saving might be the concept that it's pretty alien to the domain that we have. Like, we have a to-do application, we have to-dos, we just want to mark them as done. We don't care about them being saved, maybe. So it depends. We could have like a bit more freedom with notifications. So let's say we have a to-do, we include some kind of eventable module that will provide us basically triggering events on some listeners. So let's say we just need to add a trigger for an event after, well, let's say after mark has done, we do the thing and then trigger the actual event. So in this case, we just need to, on different platforms, we just need to provide the event handlers. So we can save it to database, we can post it to API, but this is a bit better thing if we really want to core to not care about the actual use case. So we just push an event, and we don't care what happens next. So we don't need a same interface on different platforms. They can do whatever they want after to-do is marked as done. But it is hard to compose interactions. So yeah, if you have nested ones, like one event is calling the other and so on, this leads to pretty complicated code. So, yeah, that's the con. And yeah, this is the place when we need to be aware of memory leaks in RubyMotion, because the blocks are handled in a different way in Objective-C and Ruby. And if we are not careful about using weak references and strong references there, then we can introduce memory leaks. But it's not that bad. If we want a real freedom, we can use aspect-oriented programming. And in this case, our to-do class, that is the implementation of the core domain logic, can be blissfully unaware of the surroundings. So we don't need to change it at all. So it's just mark as done. But then we use some kind of aspect-oriented library, and we can add callbacks from the outside. So for example, in the Rails application, we would have this database to-do server, and we would add a callback after marking to-do as done when the domain class does that, and then we can save it to database. And similarly, we can do that from the browser. So then we post to the service after adding the callback from the outside. So this is pretty good thing if you want the core to to not change at all and only add some code from the external platforms. But then the external platforms need to know about specifics of the cross-platform Ruby code. So whenever like the to-do markers done changes, then we probably need to change everything on each platform. So it's not that good in many cases. But it's useful when use cases are totally different on every platform. So when we don't need to save the to-do, we just don't add a callback at all, and it's great. So where to keep this logic? We can simply create cross-platform gems. And how to do that? It requires a lot of work, a bit of work, let's say, because it's not really possible to take a random gem and expect it to work on Opal and in RubyMotion because of basically require and a couple of other stuff. But require is pretty important. So for Opal, we need to somehow tell sprockets where to look for files and then require everything as usual. For RubyMotion, we are not really allowed to use require in any file that is included in runtime. So we move all requires to the gem entry point, and we need to add all those files to configuration of RubyMotion application so they can be compiled and included in the application. And the good thing about that, it actually takes 20 lines of code. So if you're interested in that, I made a blog post about that. It's really simple to modify a gem to be to work on Opal.rb and RubyMotion and Rails. And yeah, but it needs to be written in the common subset of Ruby. That's the thing. Let me show you some code. Just a sec. So the game that you've seen at the beginning of the talk, the tic-tac-toe one, it's actually created in the cross-platform Ruby. So it runs in the browser. The same code runs in the browser. The same code runs in Rails and also on iOS. So this is how the application is structured. So we have the one common directory that has different implementation for each platform. So this is basically the iOS application. This is Rails application. And this is the common gem that includes the functionality for Rails, for Opal.rb, and for RubyMotion. So this is not actually the only a tic-tac-toe game. Basically, it's a platform for any turn-based multiplayer game. And there is some abstract. There are some abstract classes like game, board, move. There is like move maker, move outcomes, player, and there is also implementation of tic-tac-toe game. So this thing is written in plain Ruby. There is no database, no GUI, no such thing. So we can test it pretty quickly. It works on every platform, and that is good. And yeah, so, and there are also things that I called interactors. So this is the thing that has all the actions that player does in the application. Do you see it? Or yeah. So basically, there are different actions. So when you start a game, we create the class. We create an object for game. Depending of game type, it could be tic-tac-toe or something else. Then we start a game like this inside of the domain logic. And then we use some kind of adapter to handle the event for starting the game. So because like starting the game could be handled differently on iOS or in the browser or in the basically Rails application. So the same thing with joining a game. What else? Finding a list of games, finding specific game, making actual move. So this is actually like taking the move representation, putting it inside of the game logic. The game logic validates the move. It will like raise an exception if something is wrong. And then it will publish some kind of event to the adapter. Well, actually call a method on the adapter to make this move. Yeah, and that's basically it. So let's see for a second how it's implemented in different applications. So in iOS, we have this game view controller, let's say. So we have like a games view controller. So this is the, I can show you what's, so this is basically something that represents, so unable to connect the internet, okay, obviously. So this is basically controller representing the list of games. And there are a couple of actions here to start a game, to join a game, and fetching all those games. So we just take this interactor, we put the REST adapter that will be responsible for handling different things in our game, and then we just add some code on events that interactor will post. So when the games are found, we just schedule the next refresh. So yeah, basically it's long polling for the games. When the game is joined, then we do some stuff like, yeah, we basically do like platform specific stuff that is driven from inside of the interactor. So this cross-platform Ruby part of the application. And so, and the same thing happens in the Opal application. So let me just show you quickly. So we have games view. Where is this adapter? Oh yeah. So we have the interactor here, and the same as before, we just need to call the interactor and then respond to any event that it posts. So from this point of view, it's like basically the same implementation on each platform. We don't need to think about what we need to do in the game logic when we start a game. Some things happen, like probably a board needs to be generated, then some things need to be saved in the database, or sent to send via internet. But we don't care about that. We just implement things that we need to do on each platform. So after game is joined, we want to go to another view, like the view of the game, and show the game to the user. If the game is started, we also change the view. And yeah, if the on this event where games are found, we just refresh the list of games with the new one. And that's basically it. So the only thing that changes is this this REST adapter. And this thing is just a simple class that needs to conform to the common interface. So it needs to have a method like start game, join game, find games, and so on. And it basically makes a post request. And on success, it triggers an event, like the game started after after request was successful, and so on, so on. So the same thing is implemented in iOS. We have also the REST adapter. It looks a bit different because we have different libraries, some platform-specific stuff. But we also do post requests here as well. But the interesting thing is that we can reuse that stuff in a Rails application. So where is it? Okay. Here we have database adapter, which conforms to the same interface, but instead of like making a post request, it just takes an active record object, creates it from database, and yeah, basically does the thing required for all validations and stuff. So, and after it's done, it also triggers the event. So the idea is to have like the same interface in the interactor and use it in the mobile application and in the Rails as well. So this looks a bit different than what we are used to, because we have the games controller, and this is basically a create application. So usually we would like take an active record, we would like take params, put like create it in a database, validate it, and so on. But this is a bit different. So here we use only interactors. We use it in the same way. So we start a game, we put params that were sent from the mobile application, then the game interactor does this thing, like validates all the game logic and all that stuff. Then it calls the database adapter, and database adapter saves everything that it needs to save, prepares database objects, and then it publishes event that the game actually started. So it's the same thing with game joined, when we have the list of games, and when we make actual move. So it feels a bit different. It definitely requires some, like everybody to if you decide to go this way, you need to like conform to the different way of doing stuff. So conform to use only the domain logic and respond to events, which looks weird in Rails controllers. But it allows us to use basically the same code on each platform. And it's kind of a good idea. So the idea is if it works, well, yes, it is. This is the proof. So you can create applications like that. Is it feasible? Not sure. Depends on your application. So it definitely adds a lot of coupling between between different platforms. So whenever you change the logic of the core of the application, you would need to change something in each platform, probably. But on the other hand, if you have use case like that, when you have some logic that is really duplicated between different applications, like mobile clients or web browser application or Rails, then it might be a way to go. So some people said that Ruby is dead. I don't believe that. I think Ruby is alive, and it's taking over the world. One platform at a time. Thanks.